Introduction to mobile telephone system. MTS or mobile telephone service. MTS is a type of service where mobile radio telephones connect people to the public switching telephone system, PSTN, to other mobile telephones or to other communication systems such as the internet. While personal communication systems or cellular personal communication service and third generation 3G mobile radio systems are all cellular wireless communication networks that provide for voice and data communication through a wide geographic area. Cellular systems divide large geographic area into small radio cells called cells. So we're going to be looking at those different types of cellular structures, hence the reason why they call them cellular phones, that are interconnected with each other. And we will talk about the whole difference in terms of electrical interference and electromagnetic interference too as well. Each cell coverage area has one or several transmitters and receivers that communicate with mobile telephones within a specific area. If we take a look at this basic cellular structure, we'll see that this PSTN, the public switching telephone network, is connected to the analog system, buildings and household, where the mobile switching center, MST, is connected to the PSTN to get from mobile telephone systems into the analog systems, where to connect to business as well as to residential home. Each mobile switching center is connected to a base station controller and a base station. These are what you call base stations, and these are what you call base station controllers. And here are what you call the cellular structure here, where a car now will be moving from one cellular coverage area to the next. So we're going to be talking about the whole concept of when that car moves away from the coverage area, how does it get to connect to a different area all entirely, or a different cellular structure. And as you can see, these two cells are different colors, and it couldn't be same as green here and green here, or let me just say this is green here and this is another green. No, it have to be green, yellow and green, or blue, yellow and blue. If it's two colors that are same, that are interconnected, they will call what you call electro mobile interference. So in figure one shows this basic cellular mobile communication system. The cellular system connects mobile radios, or what called mobile stations, via radio channels to base stations. Some of the radio channels or a portion of the digital channels are used for control purposes. We're going to talk about control channels that are used. Not only does transmit only voice, they have what you call setup and disconnection of calls, call waiting, and so on. Will be all that will be responsible in terms of the control for control purposes. Each base station contains transmitters and receivers that convert the radio signals to electromagnet signals, or electrical signals that can be sent from the mobile switching center onto the PSTN network. And we're going to take a look at those other diagrams that will explain such. So the mobile switching center contains communication controllers that adapt signals from base stations into a form that could be connected or switched. So the mobile switching center would represent what you call a router, because it is responsible for switching between other base stations or to lines that connect to the public switching telephone network. The switch system is connected to a database. We talk about the different types of database that contains active customers and customer user information as well, because you will not be able to make a call free. You have to connect to those databases as well. All right, so again, we're going to look more into detail into this. We just explained what is base stations and mobile switching center. So this mobile switching center, you know, sometimes like when you're watching a cartoon, and long time they would have these operators, just, you know, operator call me, whatever the case may be, and you'll see the operator just chucking in different codes and so on into different slots. However, through the algorithms that are developed in the mobile switching center, they no longer need operators to do so. Alright, so the switching system is in the mobile switching center is coordinated by call processing software, again algorithms, that receive requests from service and process the steps to set up and maintain connections through the mobile switching center to designation communication devices. And these designation communication devices not necessarily have to be the internet services, but also to connect to what you call a public switching telephone network. And you know, a lot of the public switching telephone network now going to Cisco based systems, where you'll be able to transmit into businesses as well as homes, but more businesses, because more businesses will set up Cisco systems and so on to cut costs. Alright, so some of the mobile technologies we're going to be looking at, first and foremost, will be cellular frequency. Cellular reuse, when you talk about the whole concept of cellular frequency and why they are reused, especially when we come to multiplexing technologies. The concept of handover or handoff. We're going to be looking at digital modulation. So we're going to talk about the whole concept of how bandpass filters and so on in terms of modulation techniques. And we will also talk about access technologies and packet data transmission. We will also be introducing it to multiplexing technologies as well. So when we talk about the concept of cellular frequency reuse is a process of using the same radio frequency on a radio transmitter site within a geographical area that are separated by a sufficient distance. As we talk about the red, green, and blue, and so on, it must have some differences between each one of those frequencies. So it will cause what you call minimum interferences for each one. Frequency reuse allows for a dramatic increase in the number of customers, so it's not all the time you're going to be on a cell phone, so you could reuse some of those frequencies as well that can be served in terms of the capacity within a geographic area. So we're going to be looking at those different types of radio spectrums that will be available for end users or mobile workstation users, otherwise known as cellular phones, who would connect and use these frequencies. And when these frequencies are not used anymore, somebody else could pick up that same frequency and transmit either voice or data. As we move along, frequency we use, if you take a look at the color code here, as I was mentioning earlier in the other slide, you will see that each one of them have base station controllers, and you will notice that this blue base station controller here to this other blue here is have some sufficient distance between them as the other colors and so on. They would not be able to have those color codes very close together. Again, why is that so? Because of the fact is that it is going to cause magnetic interferences between these signals. So they have to be of a specific distance when you're looking at the whole concept of cellular reuse. So we could look at this diagram here, for example. You see frequency 1 is here, and then quite frequency 1 is over on this side. So even though the interconnection of frequency and frequency 2 and frequency 3, there is no connection between frequency 1. So hence the reason, when it comes to frequency reuse, frequency could be reused without any form of interference taking place. All right, so here's an example of a cellular or honeycomb structure, and you could see how some of these the cellular frequency subdivided, and they are very spaced out. One's reason why these are cellular spaced out is because of the fact that you don't want interferences in signals in terms of electronic eavesdropping and so on, people listening on people calls. So we have these things are totally spaced out. And again, if you want to look at the fundamentals of frequency reuse, if you want to know the algorithms or the formula to determine cellular fundamentals in terms of the co-channel reuse ratio, it is normally divided by, or DL, mean distance between the co-channels. It could be the distance between the co-channels that I showed here earlier up in this slide here, the distance between each co-channels and so on. Right? You see channel A, channel B somewhere, the distance. And then you divide it by the cellular radius. And then the number of size, the number of cluster, which to the root of 3 end. And this cluster size now could be determined by the amount of co-channel interference as well as the number of frequency channels available per cell. And I know in geographical areas, they would have a lot on terms of co-channel interferences in terms of end the number of individuals who will be subscribing to cellular phones and so on, as well as for those areas who live in those people who live in urban areas and so on, who may have limited number of end determinations of the amount of co-channels within that specific area. So you're looking at cellular fundamentals in terms of co-channel reuse ratio, as in the distance between the co-channel cells divided by the cellular radius to the root of 3 end, which is something that you all have to know, because that will be coming somewhere in exams. So I give an example here. For example, if you wanted to find Q, which is the co-channel reuse ratio, and let me just assume that Q could be the number of N cluster size between 3, 7, 12, and 13. For example, the difference between 13 in urban areas versus 3 in rural areas, and then you will be able to determine that over the distance over the radius equal to the root of 3N. Yes, we have some mathematical algorithms and so on that we take into consideration. For example, some of you students could probably go and look up the difference between a Fourier transform series or Laplace transforms. But before, or Fourier transforms, in the difference between a sine and a cosine curve when it comes to signaling, sine curves will normally start at 0, cosine curve will normally start at 1. So, as as we move along, we'll talk about the whole concept of cell splitting now. Now, this number of cell splitting, because of the given number of subscribers within a particular area, they will have increased allocation. So a number of individuals will come into Port of Spain, for example, or San Fernando, Tobago, wherever you all live, besides those urban areas, and they would want to use up some of those frequencies there to make calls and so on. And later on, we will talk about the whole concept of visitor location registry versus the home location registries and so on. So these cellular structures will have to be split in order to accommodate the number of individuals who have cellular phones within the market. So this is done basically to increase the number of subscribers by splitting the cells. So this is a typical example how we could split the cells. And with even in cell splitting, you have to be able to set it on a color code structure in this case here, so you will have minimum interference. For example, you do not want to have cell A and cell A together, because even though you try to reduce the coverage area by lowering the power of your phone or lowering the power of the antenna, you can still have what you call electronic eavesdropping taking place. Hence the reason that long time you would find that somebody will dial a number and it will end up calling somebody else's phone even though you dial the correct number. So the whole concept of cellular hierarchy is to extend the coverage area, especially for those people who are difficult or those areas that are extremely large. And why we'd want to do this is to increase the capacity of the network for those areas that have a higher density of users, for example Port of Spain and San Fernando. So by increasing the number of wireless devices or the communication between them, so that's why normally would have a lot of base station controllers that will be set up in all sort of areas. So some of these cellular hierarchy you'll have to take into consideration is one, femto cells, which means small units of hierarchy. These cells need to cover only a few meters where all devices are in physical range of the user. For example, a personal area network, for those people who are not too familiar with PAN networks, or personal area networks, for example, Bluetooth is an example of personal area networks. You could actually make a Bluetooth to Bluetooth call without even incurring any cost on your phone. A number of people don't know that they could actually do it, but then again, who uses Bluetooth when they could actually have the Wi-Fi in, being integrated in cellular technology, where you'll be able to make like a WhatsApp call? But it's the same PAN network that normally would be used on Wi-Fi networks based on Bluetooth systems now, which is 802.13 or something standard or something. And it's something that you all will have to learn, the difference between the different technologies, the International Standards Organization, the 802.1, 802.3, the difference between the Ethernet network versus token rings, the difference between the wireless networks, the Bluetooth networks, and so on, will come under 802.11 technology and 802.13 technology. These are some of the questions that is going to be coming in exam, and it requires you to learn these different types of ISO standards and so on. So femto or pico cells now, as we coming out for WLAN technology, the size of the network for with range of more than tens of meters in terms of WLANs, and we know what WLANs mean, wide area LANs, especially for those LANs that are developed in, like Costat, for example, have different areas, or that building in particular would have a wide area network to supply the number of users who would have cellular phones, for example, to use their phones to not only to chat, but to make a call and so on. Then there's micro cells, which is cover a range of hundreds of meters, macro cells in metropolitan areas, and mega cells, for example, in satellite areas. So that is the reason why we could stay to Trinidad and make a WhatsApp call to somebody in Canada, for example, using mega cells and so on. So cellular splitting does not only just limit itself to a specific geographical area, but it also could be global too as well. So revisiting our frequency reuse, when this radio spectrum is of this, because of the fact that radio spectrum is a scarce resort, it has a lot of high demand for it, and a number of subscribers, what I mean subscribers, like cellular users and so on, use these radio spectrums to make calls, connect to YouTube, connect to WhatsApp, watch a lot of television on their mobile phones and so on. So they employ these architectures that can support many possible, theoretically speaking, when these spectrums are available. They have even have individuals who will use this spectrum to connect, even to get channels and so on outside of the electromagnetic spectrum of Trinidad and Tobago, to connect to Miami and so on by using these special satellites and so on to bypass technologies such as Flow and B-Mobile and so on. So they will actually get free coverage of or to use this free spectrum that is available. However, these spectrums are not free and they're not supposed to be used because of the fact that government have strict policies about tapping into these spectrums. Like, for example, land mobile radios will normally be instituted in, like, what does she call it, like police cars, fire engines, and especially ambulance and so on. They would normally use this through the walkie-talkie, using alternative means of communication. Some of these communication may be alternative. Yes, I said that just now. They may be simplex in terms of one-way communication, or they may be simultaneous, which we know most likely simultaneous communication takes place where you could actually two people could talk at the same time via cellular phones. So some of these spectrums could support multiple users separated by distances and does efficiency use. Hence the reason why they have cell spectrum, and hence the reason why it is important to reuse this frequency, because not much people would be on a call at this point in time. So frequency reuse has its foundation in the attenuation of signal strength, in terms of electromagnetic waves and so on. Distance between the separating the transmitter from the receiver, and the whole idea of transmitting power, which is supposed to be reasonably small, because you don't want to transmit too many power from a cellular workstation, otherwise known as a cellular phone, because you will have what you call radiation taking place. So the cellular concept is very intelligent, and it can employ different types of frequency reuse as you go along. Hope you all are following me here. Now we come to the whole concept of handoff. Handoff now is a technology where, for example, if you're driving from one metropolitan area to the next, let me say you're moving from Port of Spain to Arima. Basically, while you move from Port of Spain to Arima, you would find yourself, you know, trying to connect or trying to talk to somebody, or you're talking to somebody on a phone, for example, but you're moving from point A to point B. Your base station that is in Port of Spain would not be able to cover quite up into Arima. So handoff is the technology where our other base station will communicate to the other base station to take your call, or to assign you a different channel and so on, or reassign a new channel, so you could be always on that call while you're moving from one area to the next. So for example, again, handoff is a process where your mobile radio operating on a particular channel is reassigned to a new channel on a different base station. Alright? And I'm going to show an example in terms of handoff technology or handover technology in a little bit. But before I even move into the different handoff technology, I should make note of the difference between a hard handoff, which comes in GSM, and a soft handoff that comes in CDMA technology. And that's supposed to be CDMA, by the way. So, but I will talk about those technologies a little later down in the course, in terms of the difference between GSM, which is GSM architecture and time division multiplexing technology, versus CDMA, which is also a second generation technology that is also on a different frequency or a different network all entirely. So we'll talk about those multiple multiplexing access technologies a little bit. Alright, so there's differences in terms of handoff, because again, sometimes you may move into a specific area. For those who living into areas like between Trin City and Macoya, there's a hard handoff is take place, because the signal in itself does not really connect, in terms of there's a gap between there. So it is very difficult for handoffs to take place unless if you speed up your car and to try to catch the signal. Most of the time, the call is going to drop. All right. So this is the area here, the mobile switching center here. You'll find that this person here's signal is very weak. So he's walking. So you're seeing the interconnection here in a Venn diagram. So he would need to communicate with this base station. Will need to communicate with this other base station to hand over this this call. So this subscriber here or the user would not have his call drop. And this is what you call a handoff or handover technology. All right. So there's algorithms employed in order for you to have handoff technology takes place. Some of these algorithms, this is what they call the RSS based algorithms, where base station 2, if signal is greater than the signal from base station 1, then a handoff is going to take place, which you call a relative handoff. Alright? Talking about the concept of speech compression, and speech is another thing that is very big and large in file. So there's some form of encoding needs to take place in order to send that signal across, so you would be able to understand what type of modulation takes place, so people will be able to understand what you're saying, because they're not sufficient bandwidth to really carry out voice. Voices is very huge. Voice data is almost like the is a budget where government prepare budgets to half the money is being spent on salaries. Well, not half, 90% of the money is being spent on salaries. So we talk about these type of modulation technologies or speech compression technologies. We're looking at pulse code modulation, modulated in PCM format, which comes in three different types: sampling, quantization, and code, which I'm going to explain to you all. PCM technology, pulse code. So speech compression here, when you speak through your microphone on your phone, there's some form of converter will take place, basically like a modem or something like that. It is then it's going to create it into some form of bandpass signals. We're going to talk about bandpass signals in a little bit. Then convert it into discrete numbers, as you can see the digital analysis here. Breaks it down into a code book and then sends it back out a bandpass signal into a compressed out, so people would understand exactly what is being said on the other side. So, for example, sampleization will be taking place here. So, this is what you call a cosine curve here. And sampling would be the actual blue lines that is between here. We'll take that sampling and create what you call a discrete state, N minus 1 terms, and we'll quantize that. So, you will have discrete numbers here on a frequency. And this is an example of a sine curve here. So these discrete numbers here are going to be quantized in terms of N plus 1 technology. And that N plus 1 would use discrete values in order to look up the code book to transmit the voice. And then encoding takes place. Alright, so some of the modulation types we're going to be looking at will be the different types of multiple accessing technologies and so on, in terms of the process of changing the amplitude, the frequency, or the phase shift. Sometimes they might use all three at the same time. Most cellular technologies use all three, according to different types of broadcast storms and so on that might take place on a carrying signal now. Especially if that digital modulation uses what you call discrete numbers to carry either amplitude, frequency, or phase shift. We'll take a look at some of those phases as we move down in the slide. Alright, so look at some of these modulation types here, like amplitude shift here, for example. So you're seeing amplitude, alright, modulation here. We're seeing the difference in between the frequency shift. FSK does normally use it here. It may have some high frequency here, low frequency, and so on, as you can see how the pattern here. Then we have a pulse or phase, I should say, modulation, PSK, inserting and the change in the carrier signal, or you could have all four. Some people will use the quadruple amplitude, and this is the better one here in terms of this technology to get across the carrier signals of cause wouldn't drop and so on. So coming down now to multiple accessing technology, we will spend a lot of time discussing this, but just very briefly, the four basic multiplexing technologies will be FDMA, frequency division multiple access, TDMA, time division multiple access, CDMA, and SDMA. I would not spend much time here, for example, in terms of the multiple accessing technologies. That is a whole different topic all entirely to talk about in terms of TDMA, CDMA, and so on. So next time when we come back, or the next class, we're going to discuss those multiple accessing technologies in detail. To end off this lecture here, we talk about packet data. And of course, we don't really need to spend much time here because many of you all would know the difference in terms of the packet data, because that is exactly what you use to connect to the internet. And we have way past GPRS and edge technology. I've gone to even a further e-video where you could even transmit video, voice, and so on back and forth via WhatsApp or via MMS or any form of technology besides SMS, because SMS will still transmit basic text and so on. Alright, so this is our first slide here, introduction to mobile telephone system. As you finish this slide here, you require to do quiz 1.